Vicki Van Buren with the Flint City Council.
George Christian, Michigan DEQ.
Brian Nolan, Genesee County Board of Commissioners.
Jim Caskey, Genesee County.
Rich Baird, Governor's Office.
Nick Lyon, Michigan Department of Health and Human Services.
Lawrence Reynolds, Flint resident, retired pediatrician and senior citizen.
Mark Belichick, Genesee County Health Department.
Steve Branch.
Steve Branch, City of Flint.
Justin Londo, Michigan Office of the Auditor General.
Bill Hartman, Michigan Department of Health and Human Services.
Jared Wall, Ohio State, Michigan Department of Health and Human Services.
Talisa McDay, City of Flint.
Jerome, we have the School of Public Health, University.
Paul Newman, Core Project.
Nicole Zellner, Michigan State University, Michigan Public Health Initiative.
Larry Steckelberg, Department of Treasury. Mark McNeil, State Budget Office.
Marcy Allen, UAW Local 6000, State Employees.
Tiffany Brown, DEQ.
Okay, and we also want to thank the signers for being here as well, so Governor.
Great, well, thank you, Harvey. It's good to be with you today. I appreciate the opportunity, and I thank Michigan State for hosting us today. I look forward to a lot of good updates today. I know we have a number of things on the agenda with respect to water. I really appreciate the positive progress we've seen in water quality. I know the subcommittee's done good work on looking at issues on water rates, and I'm really looking forward to this presentation about the collaboration that took place to come up with, I think, a very strong plan for long-term water supply, which shows a great partnership between the city, county, state, federal government, and legal. So I look forward to that presentation, and again, hopefully we continue to see good progress on the jobs front, the health front, the education front, and all these services. So I look forward to a thoughtful discussion today and action items we can continue to push forward. And I appreciate the opportunity to be with the mayor and the city council and all of you. So thank you.
There we are.
Okay, good morning. Actually, you said a lot, Governor. I agree with you. I'm going to give a quick update because I want people to know that Fast Start has continued to move forward. We've gotten started again with the contractors out there this week. And even though we had a slight setback Monday with some vandalism to the equipment, one of the things we've talked about is we believe that we're still going to be on target with getting the lead service lines replaced. That has not slowed us down as of yet, and we had that conversation yesterday with General McDaniel. As far as the water recommendation, one of the things we've been continuing to do is have some public input, and we've been having focus groups. We've been keeping John very busy. Rich has been involved in those meetings. Dr. Pamela Pugh has been involved in those meetings. We were at Burston yesterday, and I think they were at the Hispanic Technology Center, but they've been going around and having small community meetings and also putting information over the radio, and that's going to continue. And I'm looking forward to the last thing is talking about the water recommendation. I keep saying a lot of hard work and effort and energy and time, and it was a great collaboration. So I'm looking forward to that, sharing that presentation with everybody.
Thank you. And we also want to welcome Bryant Nolan, who is the newest member, just was appointed a couple days ago. So thank you for hustling to get on board, who's the county commissioner for this area. So, Brian.
Yes, thank you very much, and it is our honor to be able to sit on this board. Just a quick update from the county side. I've had conversations with my chairman and some of our commissioners. I've had a conversation with Jeff Wright. I've had a conversation with our corporation council. And we're definitely in support of moving this resolution forward that we're going to be having at the end, as long as the information that's in this resolution is what we're going to be going forward with. We're definitely in support of this. And one of the things that I'm really happy about is I run an activity center in the city of Flint also, too, Burston Fieldhouse. And we had a community meeting there with some of our seniors, and it was some very good dialogue. And I really enjoyed it. And I want to thank the mayor for bringing them over to Burston. And I think that's going to be great moving around the city, having those conversations with the residents so they understand exactly what we're going to be doing going forward. But thank you so much for giving me this opportunity, Governor, and I don't take it lightly. Thank you.
Okay, and I've asked our tech folks to switch the system around so once you press it, it stays on, because this is not working that well. So hopefully I can get that fixed. George?
Thank you, Harvey. I have some very good news here with respect to the water quality update. I want to report out on the 8th round of the extended Sentinel testing program. And in that 8th round, 94.9% of the samples were at or below 15 parts per billion. And what's very encouraging is that the 90th percentile value is all the way down to 6 parts per billion now. So it continues to drive down. So not only are we holding steady at about 95% of the samples being below 15 parts per billion, but the 90th percentile continues to go down. This is now the 4th round in a row of extended Sentinel testing that has met the governor's proposed limit of 10 parts per billion. So that's excellent news right there. I'll just talk up. So in this round here, we're only 3 of the samples of the 59 tier 1 samples that are greater than 15 parts per billion. And what even drives the good news even further is 44% of these tier 1 samples actually below the detection limit of 1 part per billion. So that number continues to climb. So overall, things are looking very, very good. We'll have the 9th round of Sentinel, extended Sentinel testing done here in about the next 2 weeks. And we completed the initial round of the CLEAR testing, which stands for confirming the lead elimination after removal. So we're basically doing before and after samples for mine removal, and we'll be working in conjunction with the EPA with their testing. And so as we get further into that project, we'll have a coordinated report on those efforts.
Any questions for George? Dr. Sullivan?
George, I've got a few questions. Last time you had said that the Sentinels were going to be, the current Sentinel sample population was going to be set aside, and you're going to create a new population from the CLEAR data. Is that still true?
Well, one of the challenges that we have is as the service line efforts continue in the city, the number of tier one samples that we have in the Sentinel program continues to diminish. So at a certain point, we have to take a different look at how we obtain tier one samples. And so one of those ways is we'll be able to, once we've identified what the service line material is on these before samples, in the CLEAR program, those would be counted towards it. We anticipate, you have a puzzled look, towards the tier one for this particular round. Obviously, once those lines are replaced, we then have to go and find additional sites to add, because the city is required to have 60 per 6-month period. So we're already thinking about how we're going to approach that. We may be standing up the service line identification program again to ensure that the city has enough tier one samples for each 6-month monitoring period.
So for this that you just reported on, you had 59 tier one sites. That didn't include any of the CLEAR sites, or did it?
It did not. But keep in mind, there have already been 2 rounds of extended Sentinel testing the 6-month period, and so the city has way more than met their requirements for the current 6-month monitoring period, which ends June 30th. So the city is in great shape for this monitoring period, and so we're thinking proactively about how we're going to ensure that the city has a proper sampling pool for the next 6 months.
The thing I want to be sure of is that the data isn't getting biased away from members of the Sentinel population who withdrew, who had really high levels of lead in their water, who withdrew from the population. I'm just concerned that...
Yeah, that is not the case. And I'd be happy to talk with you about that offline.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks, George. So we're going to switch the agenda around. The next item on the agenda was the water rates subcommittee presentation, and the mayor has a conflict on the schedule, so we're going to flip to the water agreement presentation. Basically have John Young and the mayor and Rich Beard take the lead on that. And after this presentation, there is a resolution that everyone has received that we will like to consider. So with that, the mayor, we'll start with you and then.
Okay, thank you. And thank you for it, the consideration and flipping the schedule for me. I appreciate it. I'm really going to have John do most of the talking and Rich, but like we talked about earlier, we put a lot of time and effort and energy and hard work into the recommendation that we brought forward. It's something that not only the city was at the table, the state, EPA, MDEQ, the county, GLEWA, did I forget anybody? We were all there working hard to make this happen. One of the things we know that we did was when we brought this recommendation forward was public health was the top priority. That was what we kept in mind. And so with that, that was the priority, and we also wanted to make sure that we were being fiscally responsible, that we were looking out for the residents. And you know, one of the things people have talked about is needing help and support with making their water bill payments, and that part is covered in here. There's still a revenue source in there for the city. So these things will be explained, and I'm going to let, I don't know if John will start or if Rich will start, but we're really excited about the recommendation that we're putting forward. We believe out of all of the options we explored, this was the best one for the residents, looking at public health and the finances. So I'm excited about it. I hope everybody else is. And John, with that, I'm going to let you take it away.
And before you do, thank you for fixing this mic system so you can just press once and it will stay on. So thank you so much.
Secondly, while they will produce excellent water out
Great Lakes Water Authority water right now, that water would not be available once the Genesee County treatment plant was turned on. And I promise you this is the last diagram that I will show today. But I only show this because in the bottom portion of the slide there, you'll see the 72-inch primary service to Flint from Great Lakes Water. And many of you remember that that was the pipeline that was sold to Genesee County several years ago for $3.9 million, sold by the city of Flint to Genesee County. And that was going to be the hub of the Genesee County pipe distribution system. So once their plant went online, Great Lakes Water would no longer be available. So how do we bring the Great Lakes option back on the table? Well, that was one of the first work that we did. And we've got the state, we got Genesee County and the city together working out what can we do. And great thanks to Genesee County and the state as well. We were able to come up with a solution. That solution was Genesee County would lay a parallel pipeline to the 72-inch line that they would use as their new hub for their distribution system, and they would be able to return the 72-inch line back to Flint for either short-term or long-term access to Great Lakes Water. So the Great Lakes Water option was back on the table. And the reason why that was really important is because from a public health perspective, if Flint does not have to change their water source again, we have a system that's approaching or has reached equilibrium, and we do not want to introduce anything new into that system that could change. So we wanted to get the best public health option back on the table, and we were able to do that. So how do we evaluate? Now that we have three options on the table, how do we evaluate them? Well, the mayor alluded to it. Public health protection was 1, 1A, 1B, and 1C. That was most important to us. Secondly, was cost, because the lower the cost, the lower the rates. So that was number two. And as I've gone out to the public, and I've done this for 40 years, the first question is always public health, and the second question is what's it going to cost me? Frankly, in some communities, the first question is what's it going to cost me? Because they just assume that public health is going to be good. The third was reliability. We wanted to make sure whatever we did, we can assure ourselves there was going to be sufficient quantity of water available for Flint short and long term. And the fourth was how quickly it was going to take us to implement the recommendation, because Flint has a lot of other issues they need to address, and we don't need a lingering water source issue for the next 2 or 3 years while we go out there and replace lead service lines and do all the other things we need to do as a city. So that was our evaluation criteria. So what is it going to cost for us to renovate the Flint treatment plant? We didn't have an answer when we started this analysis, so we brought in some of the best minds in the country to take a look at what needed to be done. The quality of the Flint River is different than the quality of Lake Huron. Frankly, the quality of Lake Huron is much better than the Flint River. But the fact that it's different requires a different treatment process. So for instance, we soften the water out of the Flint River. We're not going to need to soften the water out of Lake Huron. And there's several other process changes that need to be done. So when you take a look at the process modifications that are required to the plant, plus the plant has 50, 60, 70-year-old infrastructure associated with it, and we needed to improve the reliability. The cost of the improvements of the facility is about $58 billion. And if we were to add raw water storage, which may or may not be needed for reliability, that was another $50 million. So now we have the cost information we needed regarding the plant. And I will tell you that a year ago, we started an operator training program so that we can move forward to get the operator trained. But this program here was going to take 2 to 3 years to implement. So we were 3 years down the road from this, so we would need an interim supply for the city. So let's get a little bit into the economics, because that was the second part. We generally from a public health perspective, we said, you know, if we don't have to switch source, that's the best. If we have to switch source once, that's second best. If we have to switch source twice, that's third best. So that was relatively easy. From a cost perspective, we generally had an idea what KWA water was going to cost. We now knew what it was going to cost to renovate the Flint treatment plant. Genesee County gave us the cost of their water if we were to purchase their water. Now we went to the best public health solution and see, can we make this most cost effective? Well, right now, the city of Flint is paying around $21 million for their water. That's broken down between $14 million from Great Lakes Water, and there's a $7 million bond obligation that the city has for the KWA facilities that were built, the intake, the pipelines, the pump stations, and they're paying that right now.
That's per year, right?
That's per year. These are annual payments. Now, $14 million is higher than the normal Great Lakes water rates because Flint is on an emergency contract. When the plant went back offline and Great Lakes came in, they came in on a temporary basis, and so the price is around $14 million a year. Now, that is a big driver of why we have rate issues in Flint, among a number of other issues. What we did is we took a look at how do we make the Great Lakes water alternative most cost-effective. Well, there was two ways to do it. One was to go under a long-term contract with Great Lakes Water and get that $14 million down, because as a long-term customer, those rates go down. And secondly, was there any way, if we use Great Lakes Water as our finished supply, can we get rid of that $7 million a year bond obligation? And we went through extensive negotiations, et cetera, with Great Lakes Water, and it was a truly a cooperative effort. And at the end of the day, this is what we ended up with. We would go under a 30-year contract with Great Lakes Water, and the cost for that water would drop down to $11 million a year. And then, one of the things that Flint does not have right now is a backup supply. The sole pipe that goes to the city of Flint is a 72-inch line that comes in from Great Lakes Water. If there was a failure of that line, the only water available to the city would be the water that we have in storage. It's a DEQ requirement and recommendation that you do have a backup supply. So when Genesee County's new treatment plant goes online, we will now have an independent supply available, and that's the second cost component you see right here. So for a total of $12.2 million, Flint gets all the water that they need, as well as having a backup supply from Genesee County. Now, how did that $7 million of KWA debt go away? Well, Great Lakes Water took a long, hard look at the situation and said, you know, there may be some economic and operational value for us assuming Flint's position, not necessarily the position to back the bond payment within the KWA. And why was that? Well, certainly Great Lakes Water wanted to maintain Flint as a long-term customer. They're about 5% of the overall revenue for Great Lakes Water. But additionally, if they maintain Flint as a customer, they'd be able to avoid some capital projects, which is a big advantage to them. On top of that, they would be able to improve the reliability of supply to existing customers in the area, because other customers water serves off of this long 72-inch pipeline also only had a single supply. So for them, acquiring some of the water rights that Flint had from KWA and getting it treated at the Genesee County plant, they now have a backup for their other customers, which was great from a regional solution. And then they could develop a reciprocal agreement with Genesee County to help each other kind of mutual aid. This is the perfect regional solution. So with that, with these benefits, they decided that they can eliminate the KWA bond debt for Flint. So Flint will, every year, just looking at it on an annual basis, Flint would get a water bill for $12.2 million. They would pay Great Lakes Water $5.2 million, and they would put $7 million into a trust that ultimately pays the KWA bond debt. On the left-hand side, the $21.1 million, if that continued, we'd be looking at about a 47% rate increase within the city of Flint. On the right side, if we're able to go down there, we think we can hold rates flat. We've just initiated a rate study, but that's basically the gap that Flint has in their budget to avoid a rate increase. Now, at the end of the day, we looked at about 12 different options, various combinations of Gleewa, Genesee County, and Flint being primary, backup, interim, things such as that. And we've developed a ranking of each one of the options from public health cost, reliability, and implementation time. The option that we're recommending here today, or the mayor's recommending today, was number one, public health, number one cost, which means minimal rates, number one in reliability, and number one in implementation time. Implementation time is zero. We're getting the water right now. The system has reached an equilibrium, and we're just going to stay on it to not impact public health. Interestingly enough, and I hate to bring out this point, if you look at the two most expensive alternatives, they would be buying water from Great Lakes Water or Genesee County and having a treatment plant as your backup supply. And unfortunately, that's the scheme that Flint had been using for years as their primary and backup supply. So we're moving to city of Flint for this recommendation with a number of them. We talked about the preferred public health option. It is the lowest cost solution, which means the least impact on rates. One of the really important things here is the federal government, you know, has given Flint $100 million worth of grant money to spend on its system. The state has stepped up and matched it with $20 million. So there's $120 million there that can be spent. We know about $50 million is going to be allocated to the lead service line replacement program. That leaves $80 million. If we had implemented the alternative where we had to renovate the Flint treatment plant, 58 of that 80 would have had to go into the treatment plant. Now we can spend all $80 million on our buried infrastructure. Stop going after those leaks, going after some of the water age problems that we have, the storage problems that we have. It's much, much better use of the money. The 72-inch line that I talked about, that now gets returned back to Flint. They sold it for $3.9 million, Flint gets it back for nothing. Not a bad deal. GLIWA steps in and takes care of the 28-year, $7 million a year bond obligation. That's $196 million that Great Lakes Water will step up and support Flint with. The solution is the quickest implementation time. We go under a long-term contract with Great Lakes Water, so that $14 million a year goes down to $11 million a year under a long-term contract. When Great Lakes Water was formed, 0.5% of all the revenue was to go to a low-income assistance program. They call it their RAP program, and it's divided up by county. Flint will be the sole buyer of water within Genesee County, so all of the Genesee County money to the RAP program, the low-income program, goes to the residents of the city of Flint. One of the, as I've gone out and I've spoke to a lot of people in the public within the city, one of the concerns is if we go into a 30-year contract with Great Lakes Water, how do we control rates? So we did a lot of due diligence on Great Lakes Water. We looked at what's happened since they moved from Detroit Water to Sewer. Now, a lot of good things are going on. They've reduced operating costs, they've reduced bond debt, they have energy management programs in place. And there's an MOU that was created when Great Lakes Water was formed that basically says we will try to stay within a 4% revenue requirement, which is somewhat related to a rate increase each year, and they've been able to stay within that. And I looked at their books and it looks like they'll be able to do that moving forward. So we think we have a 30-year contract and long-term commitment. We think we have a large regional utility that's efficiently run, that can use economies of scale and expertise of scale to keep it that way. We now have a backup source for Flint, which we don't have right now. And one of the things I hope happens, there's no guarantee of this, but if we can stay on Great Lakes Water, a firm maybe like General Motors who went off the system, who's now on Great Lakes Water, will come back to Flint, and that would be approximately $500,000 a year of revenue. So what's the next steps? Well, the next steps is we are now in the public feedback period. That ends pretty soon, but we're going to continue to go out to community groups and talk to them. We've initiated a rate study. Now that we have our recommendation in place, what will happen with rates, and we're going to work very closely with the quick rate subcommittee in designing ultimately those rates to see how we can help the low-income residents of Flint. We hope to finalize all the agreements by May, and believe me, there are a lot of agreements that need to be done. I've been in this business for 40 years, and this is the most complex water agreement I've ever seen, just because of the number of parties. But it's an agreement where everybody wins. A successful collaboration is where everybody wins. And in this case, we were able to pull that off. And I may be a little prejudiced, but I think Flint was the big winner in all of this. And then once we get approvals, which we hope to get by June, and we'll have to get approvals from each one of these bodies, we'll then start spending some of that $120 million in building some of the projects we need to make this work. So that's the pitch. Rich, do you want to add a little bit?
Thank you, John. John, that was excellent. There's three points that I would like to underscore and provide some additional clarification on. First of all, why did we initially think a year ago that staying with GLWA was not an option? And the reason is that we had sold the 72-inch pipeline to Genesee County, and that was going to be put in place as part of the KWA system. And so we did not believe that we had an alternative. Secondly, we mistakenly thought that the water treatment plant and the water delivery system was held as security for the county to provide full faith and credit to the bondholders' assurances. And as it turns out, that wasn't the case. And so working with Genesee County, we were able, as John said, to work through these issues and actually do something that we thought for quite a long time was an impossibility. Secondly, there's a natural question that comes, if this is such a good deal and wholesale rates are going to be savings for Flint from what we're currently paying, why can't we roll back rates and offer that up to the residents? And I think a fundamental issue here is you have wholesale rates and you have retail rates. Now the fact is that once the water comes to Flint, the inefficiencies, the leakages, the things that John mentioned within the water delivery system, which is too large for the population, which has inefficiencies and leakage built into it, basically puts us in a position that we have to use and we need to protect the funds, the federal funds that we have, to address those issues in order to stabilize and hopefully in the future create some rate rollback opportunities from what is a very significant and high rate customer based system. I know that later on in this meeting we have an update on the rate study that's been going on, but it's important to realize that there is a relationship between fixing the water delivery system and with one of the other options that John had mentioned, we could go ahead and stand up the treatment plant. We could go ahead and stand up a backup reservoir. That would cost us over $100 million. And then we still would have all of the issues associated with efficient water delivery within the system. So that's another reason why this is so attractive. The last point I'd like to underscore is one that is kind of near and dear to a lot of us. The governor and I actually had a role in helping stand up the Great Lakes Water Authority, and it is not the old DWSD dressed up as something different. It truly is a representative governance model which requires a supermajority in order to approve contracts over a certain amount and in order to approve rate adjustments. All of the same things that caused Flint heartache as it relates to unsustainable rate increases from the old Detroit Water and Sewer were the same things that caused Livonia and Plymouth and Pontiac and Birmingham to head for the hills, because they basically were saddled with wholesale rates that were not sustainable as a result of Detroit's lack of capital reinvestment in their system and lack of ability to collect water rates from their customer base. That has all changed, and John alluded to the operating efficiencies, the reduction in debt, and the reduction in operating costs that GLEWA has enjoyed. So it's important for folks to understand that the Great Lakes Water Authority is not simply the old DWSD. It is now governed in a way that requires $50 million of annual capital reinvestment into the systems. And also, John also referenced the water relief program that takes a half a point and puts that in to help people who are struggling with their water rates. And all of these things together provide for an assurance and a model that says this is sustainable long-term and we don't have to worry about rate gouging as soon as bad management takes over GLEWA. The governance model simply doesn't permit that. Those are the points I wanted to reinforce, John. Thank you.
So I guess maybe we can open it up for questions that the mayor or Rich and I can hopefully respond to. Believe me, this is a very complex deal and we've just hit it at 60,000 feet. Yes, Laura?
I've got a couple of questions. The KWA met yesterday, day before yesterday, and discussed the very same graphic that you had presented. And one of the questions that I brought up and I'm not quite sure about the answer that I got, was that in the bylaws for the KWA, it indicates that water or capacity can't be bought or sold by anybody other than the five entities that belong to the KWA. And I wanted to make sure, before we got too far into this, that I was clear from the KWA perspective on what's allowed. And what Jeff Wright said at that meeting was that Flint can sell water to another entity, like Portland, but that sale has to happen in the city limits for it to be okay. And my question then was, GLEWA doesn't really touch any water in the city limits of Flint, so how do we sell that water to them there? And he put out as a hypothetical that GLEWA would be putting in a water treatment plant in the city of Flint. So I guess my question is, basic question, are we making sure that we're not, in this idea, doing something that the KWA board will vote down and because of the bylaws? And then do we have an idea about how that sale is going to happen?
Okay, well, I can't speak 100% for the legal, but I'll attempt to answer that question. You notice on the slide that I put up the advantages of this deal for GLEWA, you notice nowhere on that slide was acquiring 18 million gallons a day of water rights from Flint. The way GLEWA looks at it is they can avoid, like I said, avoid some projects. They keep a customer. But what they will do is they will take, under an emergency situation, some of those water rights that they have acquired from Flint, have that water treated at the Genesee County plant and distributed to their customers within the area. That's the reliability portion that they pick. They also are integrating both the Genesee County and the Great Lakes water system to improve reliability. If at some point in the future there was ways to use the rest of that water that required the construction of a treatment plant or something besides having to treat it at Genesee County plant, that may happen, but that is way down the road. This is all about regional solutions and reliability within the region. And that's what it's going to be, probably short-term and potentially long-term.
So for the purposes of an argument back to KWA, as a person from Flint, I can say that what GLEWA is purchasing is the rights to access to that 18 million, but not purchasing that water someplace other than the city.
It is for the rights to that water. In fact, Flint has made some bond obligations, so we're going to retain a half a million gallons a day of those water rights, and 17 and a half will go to Great Lakes Water. But that's basically unusable unless it gets treated right now at the Genesee County Treatment Plant for distribution under an emergency.
Okay, and then one other question. When Flint financed to be part of the KWA, there was an administrative consent order involved that had to do with Flint's obligation to clean up some solid waste with KWA water. Do we have a plan for how Flint will attend to that waste, since we made a commitment on that consent order to use KWA water to do that?
I'm an engineer, not a lawyer, so that's being discussed with the lawyers right now. I don't know the answer. That's okay. The questions I don't know the answer.
Okay, thank you.
John, if I could just also add, because you mentioned the 500,000 gallons a day, that was also, I think, a well-negotiated part for Flint, because, as we all know, not unlike a mortgage, at the early parts of a mortgage, you pay predominantly interest and only a little principal. Under this agreement, we basically were able to get all parties to agree that the monies that Flint paid in would represent total equity. So basically, they come out with a 3% equity stake in GLEWA, and the only caveat to that or condition to that is that GLEWA would have first right of refusal before they sold that KWA equity interest.
Yes. Thanks, that was a great presentation, and I commend the mayor and everybody who was working on this. I think I breathed a sigh of relief when I heard this decision, especially from the public health perspective. The 1.1 million that we have to pay Genesee County to maintain the backup, is that just guaranteed? Like, if we use it or don't use it, we still have to pay that 1.1 million?
Well, let me explain that. This gets into the details. The size of the pipe that has to come off the Genesee County system to be an adequate backup has to supply at least average day demand. So the size of that pipe might be a 24 or 36 inch pipe, and you can't let that pipe sit stagnant because the water will, will deteriorate over time. So we're going to have at least a 500,000 gallons a day continuously going through that pipe. And then what we will do is we will blend the 95% of the legal water with the 5% of the Genesee County water, so we have a consistent water quality, and then we may add chlorine to it or something as it goes into the system. So a lot of that is basically minimum flow requirements and some operating costs associated with that.
And if we do need to use that as a backup, does that cost increase, that price increase?
No, because what will happen is, it's interesting, we're only going to get one bill, and that's from Great Lakes Water. So if we don't get water through the 72, we'll bring it through the backup line, and it will be charged at the same rate. So it doesn't change under backup situation.
All right, another question. You touched on General Motors, who has left the system and is no longer a paying customer. Is there a way to mandate that they come back since they left? Or, I mean, are people looking at that? I mean, that is a huge customer. There's a...
It's about $500,000 a year.
Right, there's some egregiousness in their leaving and what they knew and when they knew. I mean, like, I don't want to get into that, but I think it would be great if efforts were brought to the table to bring them back in as a customer. So I don't think he's working on that.
I don't want to speak for General Motors, but people are looking at it, conversations are taking place, and General Motors has said privately that when they are confident in the quality of the water, that they would like to return to the Flint system. And it would be my hope that this agreement would provide that confidence.
And my last question. So you touched on the Flint bill that passed and the $120 million that was going to come to Flint for infrastructure, and that about $60 million was going to go to upgrades to the plant, which we no longer will be spending. And I understand the need to invest in the infrastructure that we have because of leaks and inefficiencies. Is there any possible way to use even part of that savings that was going to go to the infrastructure for rate support at this time, or is that impossible because of the legislation that was written?
John, you may want to field this one, but there is a correlation between the efficiency of the system and the cost, the retail cost. So without getting out of my swim lane, logic would say to me that if we fix the infrastructure and the delivery, that rate rollbacks should be in the future. And I just would like to underscore that it's not only the size of the infrastructure that we're talking about, but we've got water mains that need to be replaced because they're prone to breakage in the wintertime. We have pumping stations that need to be implemented. We've talked in the past about the city's desire to put technology plates and monitoring systems in many places. I think the number is around 20 or more around the community, so that as water passes over these plates, to use a medical analogy, if the water has a sniffle, Space Command is going to know whether it's an allergy, if so, what's the allergy to, or whether it's a cold, a flu, or pneumonia. And that kind of monitoring capability will have a huge impact on Flint's ability to manage its water delivery.
I mean, I absolutely recognize the need to invest in our infrastructure, which is old and aging and oversized, but even half of that money, if half of that went to some sort of rate support, is, I mean, I think it would speak volumes in terms of rebuilding trust, especially in the short term rather than in the long term.
Under the current legislation, that would not be possible. But I do think that the sooner the city is able to address these issues,